Hello world, it's Suraj. And if you only have a little bit of data, can you still learn from it? We're gonna build a model that learns to classify images using a very small data set for training. Deep learning is still very much a dark art. It's an emerging practice in the world of machine learning that isn't well understood even by those pushing the state of the art, which is exciting because it means that there's so much potential for discovery. And it's not just one algorithm, it's a collection of them. Recurrent nets, convolutional nets, restricted Boltzmann machines, Barbra Streisand. These are all networks that can recognize patterns in the world, and they themselves have shared patterns. One shared pattern is that they all use a hierarchy of layers. The other is using differentiable layers so that we can use gradient-based optimization to improve their prediction. Design patterns are nothing new in computer science. There are many books on design patterns for topics like object-oriented programming and user interfaces. But when it comes to deep learning, there's not really a definitive design pattern guide. We're all kind of figuring it out collectively right now. You might glaze over a deep learning paper and assume that there is some solid mathematical foundation behind what the researchers attempted because you see all sorts of equations for things like Hilbert spaces and measure theory. But the reality is that our collective understanding is still pretty minimal. Theories are often formulated because they are mathematically convenient. For example, the Gaussian distribution is ubiquitous, not because it's some divine construct that the universe has bestowed on us, but because it's mathematically convenient. So defining standard design patterns for pattern recognition networks is a field ripe for discovery. In the context of machine learning, we can call it meta-learning or learning to learn. Can we design a system that learns how best to learn? That is, it learns how to perform well at an immediate task in the short term, and in the long term, it learns a common structure across many tasks. We see meta-level constructs in nature all the time. DNA is a great example. It carries the instructions, the blueprint, to create learning systems that can expire our brains, but it acts as long-term memory by transcending death, just like Oracle. As long as there is a mechanism for memory and one to alter behavior based on that memory, then that mechanism can serve as a meta-level construct. In the past few months, there have been several papers on meta-learning that have been published, but I want to talk about one that uses meta-learning as a tool to solve another task, one-shot learning, the goal of learning from one or only a few data points. This is what we should be aiming for since GPU costs are too damn high. They used a modified version of a model called a neural Turing machine to learn to classify character images with just a few examples. DeepMind first drew up the idea of NTMs in 2014. It contains two components. The first is a neural network that we call the controller, and the other is a memory bank. The controller takes vectors as inputs and outputs vectors as well, just like all neural nets. But what makes it special is that it also interacts with a memory matrix using read and write operations. This is where the Turing machine analogy comes from. Not just because it sounds dope, but because a Turing machine manipulates symbols on a strip of tape according to a table of rules. It's like having a working memory for a brain. The network learns how best to use its memory when learning a solution to a given problem. For the controller, they used an LSTM recurrent network since its internal state is a function of the current state and the input to the system. It can perform context-dependent computation, so a signal at a current time step can influence the network's behavior later on. We need all the components, including the memory store, to be differentiable so that we can incrementally update their values during training. To achieve this, they added an attention mechanism so that each read and write operation interacts to a tunable degree with all the elements in memory, rather than addressing a single element like a normal Turing machine would. Each row in the memory matrix represents a memory location. Read and write heads use a weighting vector with a component for each location. So if there are 10 memory locations, then the weighting vector with just one value at index 3 would focus the attention of the memory operation on location 3. But a weighting vector like this spreads its attention to the memory across multiple locations. A read operation is just a combination of the memory matrix and weighting vector. A write operation, though, has two parts, an erase operation, then an add operation. The way these read and write heads are produced is by combining two memory addressing mechanisms. The first is content-based. We focus on locations based on the similarity between their current values and the controller's emitted values. The second is location-based. It facilitates iterations across locations of the memory and random access jumps.
And memory bank. Read and writes are so dank. So dank.
So the authors of our one-shot learning paper knew that NTMs were a subset of memory-augmented neural networks, and they saw the potential to improve on it so that they could learn from just a little data. They discovered that using a pure content-based memory writer instead of content plus location let them do just this. That's because there's a trade-off when training MANNs. The more complex the memory mechanism, the more training the controller requires. The dataset has 1,600 separate classes and only a few examples per class, perfect for one-shot learning. They randomly selected 5 classes, then randomly assigned each class a label between 1 and 5. So the model gets shown an instance of a class, tries to classify it, then it gets informed of what the correct label is. We'll only need TensorFlow and NumPy for our model. We'll first define our memory bank, initializing each of the variables that make it up, then we can define our controller, a feed-forward neural network. We'll define each set of weights and biases layer by layer until we've reached the output layer. We can define the interaction that happens between both components under the step function, which is called every time step during training. Just like with a regular NTM, we read a vector from memory that is a linear combination of its rows scaled by a normalized weight vector. For the given input x, the read vector will produce a key. We compare each key against each row in memory using the cosine similarity as a measure. This produces the read weight vector, which tells us how much each row should contribute to the linear combination. The difference here is that there is no extra parameter to control the read weight vector's concentration. To write to memory, the controller interpolates between writing to the most recently read memory rows and writing to the least used memory rows. Using the read weight vector at a previous time step and the weight vector that captures the least used memory location, the controller combines the two using a scalar parameter and the sigmoid function to create a write weight vector. Each row in memory is then updated using the write weight vector and the key issued by the controller. The model eventually returns the probabilities for each class as a vector. After we've initialized our TensorFlow session, we use gradient descent via Atom to optimize our network. For every image label pair, we feed in via a dictionary. We'll print out our results iteratively. After training, we can test it out on some different recognizable characters and notice how the accuracy is surprisingly good. Normally, training time would take a lot longer for similar results. These results are very promising for one-shot learning.
And that's all it takes to train, folks.
Let's get down to brass tacks. A meta-learning system learns how to perform well at an immediate task and also learns a common structure across many tasks. Memory-augmented neural networks, like the neural Turing machine, use a controller and an external memory store to perform meta-learning. And meta-learning can be a way to achieve one-shot learning, which means learning from one or a few examples. This week's coding challenge is to use a memory-augmented network to learn to classify 2 classes of animals. Details are in the README, GitHub links go in the comments, and winners will be announced in 1 week. And although this is the last video for this course, I'm still just getting started. Please subscribe for more programming videos, and for now, I've got to go celebrate, so thanks for watching.